Okay, today we're looking at another, not a news article so much, but this is a different Melody Maker article. This one written by Harry Doherty, and this is from 18th November 1978. So last time we were talking about a write-up about the Bay City Rollers in 1974, and it had some optimistic stuff going on about it. Very little real criticism of the band, which is kind of rare for them, right? And we're going to get into this in a bit, but I want to go back. And so I received a few pieces of opinion and information, I guess you would say. Number one was that I had said, yeah, probably the guys didn't have girlfriends and they were living a claustrophobic life. But I've been told they most certainly would have had girlfriends. Probably true, I guess, right? I'm not going to disagree with that. I don't know, right? The other thing was, I keep mentioning how their clothing was inspired by the whole skinhead look. And I was told that generally the skinhead thing didn't really take off in Scotland the way it did in the South. And so my feeling about that, so it was not based off of the skinhead thing. Now, my feeling about that, there's two things. One is that it seemed to me, and I'm going to put a link actually to this, that something was going on in Edinburgh, something really special, because in 1973, I do believe they had the Edinburgh reggae festival, right, which had some of the big heavy hitters of from that point and like a little bit earlier that would have been huge. These reggae artists were huge in the skinhead community, right? And so I thought, gee, they must have had like a bit of a community there to have this. And I think it was Judge Dredd that was the master of ceremonies of that thing, right? But that doesn't mean anything. That's kind of like, when I talk about evidence and stuff like that, that's not evidence of anything. Because generally, because of the huge population in the UK, the music spread all around. Skinhead or not, people were hearing this music, right? So it doesn't mean anything. But you know, if you look at pictures of Derek early on with the Ben Sherman inspired shirt and the braces and then the white was really common at one point in time for the skins, especially though like the Levi's Stay Press type of stuff, right, which is a little bit different. But that doesn't mean, and I'm not saying that the Rollers themselves were inspired by the skinheads. What it was is that that fashion, after the mods, it was the big thing, you know, and it spread around quite a bit, but it doesn't mean that everyone that was wearing it was into reggae, right, or into getting into fights after a football match and stuff like that. But I find it all interesting how, because it's so different from the fashions, like that stuff just didn't happen over here. Some of the mod stuff made it over here. But that was more people trying to look like the Beatles, like in the early 60s, right? And then, you know, in the 70s, the world kind of opened up and trends moved back and forth. And so the mod thing kind of came over here. And ska, which came before reggae, became popular over here, right? After all these years, because in the 60s, the original ska from Jamaica had a very small blip of success and then disappeared completely in the United States, right? Anyway, so that's my thoughts on that. But let's get into this horrible piece. And I have to be careful because, you know, for copyright reasons, first of all, I have to add my opinion to this in order to use it. I got no problem doing that. But the other thing is I can't read the entire thing, so there'll be pieces left out. But I don't think you're missing much. Okay, so Harry Doherty, Melody Maker, 18th November 1978. Starts off, this is the first paragraph, and it's called The Bay City Roller Strangers in the Wind. So it's a review. It would indeed be wonderful to report that after a lengthy break, the Bay City Rollers have returned to remind us that they were really a great pop band. It would also have spared me the torment of writing yet another put down of the short-legged ones. So, I'm getting the feeling this isn't going to be a great review. But here's the punchline. Next paragraph. But the unfortunate reality is that, given even more control of their destiny, it becomes more apparent that the Rollers were most effective in their past roles as put pets to Bill Martin and Phil Coulter. Saturday Night, All of Me Loves All of You, etc. Okay, let's just stop right there. Does this person know anything about what he's talking about? Forget Strangers in the Wind right now. Okay? Let's think about the albums Once Upon a Star. Let's think about Wouldn't You Like It? And let's think about In North America, the Rock and Roll Love Letter compilation, where every song but one is written by the band. Let's think about how absolutely on point stuff like Wouldn't You Like It, Eagles Fly, you know, and how perhaps simple but great La Belle Jeunesse, Marlena, you know, never mind how great their covers, Rock and Roll Love Letter and Bye Bye Baby were, you know. So all of that is thrown aside. Saturday night and All of Me Loves All of You. Really? You think that was the great stuff that they recorded? You've already discounted yourself. You don't know anything about what you're talking about. Because they far surpassed all of that stuff. And I'm not coming in here to put down Martin and Coulter because you can't. They're experts, so it doesn't matter. But anyone that's trying to sell this ticket is ripping you off because the stuff the band wrote goes far beyond all of this. But this person obviously doesn't know that, or this person has an axe to grind. So now I have to choose what else I'm going to read. Well, I don't know what else you have to read from someone like this, right? You know, many songs are written and, there's a lot of insults towards them. Okay. And it ends with Strangers in the Wind is bland, harmless, and totally dispensable slop pop. Strangers in the Wind is the Bay City Rollers, right? So no, the Bay City Rollers are so many things at so many different points in time. So we still, you know, at this point, we haven't heard what's going to be coming from the Bay City Rollers in the near future. But the thing is this, sometimes it's acceptable that someone can miss out on what's actually going on with music, and then time passes and you say, you know what, this was better than I thought or whatever. But what is inexcusable here is that we have an entire history of the band that this person throws out. Incredible stuff, right? That he just throws out in order to say that Saturday Night and All of Me Loves All of You is the best the band could do. It's absolutely a lie. The person has an axe to grind, and I hope the person got paid per word because there aren't very many words in this, but more importantly, I hope he was paid for each intelligent word, of which there are very few in this review. Very sad. But let's get back to Strangers in the Wind, right? So I heard Strangers in the Wind shortly after it came out. Now, shortly at my age can mean many different things. My memory isn't that great, but it wasn't the 1990s or anything that I heard it. I heard it shortly after it came out. What was my feeling on it? My feeling was that at first hearing it, I couldn't believe that this was the direction that they were continuing to go in, because I had already heard the Ramones and stuff like that, right? And I thought, this is not, obviously not a commercially successful album. Okay? And it wasn't. Could it have done better with more support from the label? Yes. Of course. The label was useless at that point in time, right? Well, they, you know, they weren't getting along. So how, you know, if you have that kind of thing where the label and the band is not getting along, I don't know how you create a great album, right? They were not handled the same way that Steely Dan was, where Steely Dan could sit there for a year doing drugs or whatever. I don't know if they're doing drugs. I'm just kind of making that up. And then suddenly come up with an album at the end of it all, right? But Strangers in the Wind wouldn't have been going in the direction that I expected that they would go in. But there are several great songs on the album, and there are some very good covers on there as well. Matter of fact, this person puts down their cover of The Pie. I'm like, you're absolutely out of your mind on this one. Absolutely out of your mind. He actually says, he describes their inability as musicians. Oh my God, give me a break. There is no evidence of any inability on this album at all. That's just making stuff up. Listen to the title track, Strangers in the Wind. Where's the inability in there? Ridiculous. You don't like their songwriting. Okay, on this, I get that. But you're also missing out on so many years of music, so many dozens of songs. But whatever. But my point is, for myself, and when I heard this album, the thing is, in popular music, trends change overnight. And I have several other articles that I'll be reading in the future, and I think in one of them, Alan's like, yeah, we know that trends change overnight. Everything could be completely different tomorrow, you know. We'll do our best, that type of thing. Trends change overnight, and we always think that that bands that are in control of their destiny, when many times they're not, but we also think that they can choose, oh yeah, we'll do this, we know this will be popular. No one knows. It's still art, even though it's pop music, it's still art. And no one really knows exactly what's going to happen. Like, the people that heard the first Ramones album thought it was a joke, and yet it changed music forever. Right? For better or worse, depending on your opinion, right? And the thing is that with the stuff that the Bay City Rollers were doing with Wouldn't You Like It, it was heading directly towards what the Ramones were going to do, right? And the thing is, the band doesn't know exactly what's going to be happening, but the other thing is they don't know where they're going to be welcome. You know, Les tried to do some stuff towards like the new wave and punk stuff and was generally not accepted. It was very difficult to get accepted into that, right? So who knows what direction to take? But the fact is, with Strangers in the Wind, I think we actually have a very authentic album of a band who were writing and performing songs about how they felt at the time. It was very real. And I like the album. And when I did my first video, I said, you know what? This is one of their best albums, even though it is overproduced. And I like the stripped down stuff without the strings and stuff like that. Like, Wouldn't You Like It would be like a perfect example of what I wanted from the band. But it's still a great album. And so, was there something else that I wanted to add to this? Oh, dear, there's so much, you know. It's all very complicated stuff. I'm going to pause for a second and gather my thoughts. Okay, so yeah, one point I'd like to make is that it is excusable if you don't know what's going to happen. So this writer didn't know what was going to happen with the Bay City Rollers, and he didn't know, for example, the music that Eric Faulkner was going to write in the future that could have been used by the Bay City Rollers. So that is excusable. I was saying before, it's inexcusable to ignore all the great stuff they had after the Martin and Coulter period, right? Even if you don't like Strangers in the Wind and you don't like the direction they're heading in. That's perfectly acceptable. If you don't like that, you don't listen to it. But here's the thing for me, and I kind of said this before. I think the Rollers kind of didn't know where to go and were kind of lost for quite some while, and I think maybe Eric was as well, because you're a pop band. That makes it very difficult. You know, if you're a prog band, just keep doing your prog music, you know. A pop band has to have hits, and so it becomes very challenging. But the thing is, I was talking about Wouldn't You Like It, and I've mentioned many times that that's kind of real Britpop that they were doing there. And I do find that Eric, you know, he has this new album, Faulkner, actually. Go listen to that, and it shows that he is one of the greatest Britpop songwriters of all time. But he's also allowed to go in whatever direction he wants, because now he is also an excellent folk artist, you know? What I find with Eric Faulkner is that regardless of whether the music genre that he's writing in is my type of genre, I still enjoy the music. For example, I did a cover of his song, Food Bank on the Moon. Not my type of music at all, but I like that song that he wrote, and I really enjoyed doing the cover of it, you know? So at the end of the day, what does it matter with the critics? The only, you know, even if a critic writes horrible things about your albums, if fans like it, they buy it, you know? It's as simple as that. But also, you know, fans are fickle, and any changes are always full of risk for anyone out there, right? And we all know this. So, you know, my point still stands, which is after the Martin and Coulter era, the band became better. And they had, if you want to just talk about great pop songs, they had a tremendous number of pop songs that the label did nothing with. And now this guy comes along and says, well, they weren't any good. Well, no, they were great, but the label did not support them. The label had their own objectives, and that objective was not to promote the songwriting of this band, right? And so that was a failure. And they lost a huge chance for a band that could have gone on for another 10 years. If the label had said, wow, this stuff on Wouldn't You Like It is great. Keep going. Keep going, because you guys are doing great. We would have had a completely different outcome. But still, do you want to miss out on stuff like Strangers in the Wind? I don't think so. So it's all so complicated, and it's all history, and it's all time, and time passes, and you can't control these things, right? But the fact is, we have a ton of great records and recordings to listen to. And then when you get into the stuff that Eric started writing later on, it's just, you know, incredible. And then let's not forget the stuff that Duncan wrote, you know. So it's a tremendous, very rich, tremendous amount of music that was created by the band and by members of the band going on afterwards. This little write-up is a complete insult to what they had accomplished at that time. People didn't buy all of these albums because they wanted to hear more Saturday Night. We bought those albums because we heard those songs and we loved them, and we played them into the ground. Anyway, have a good night, and thanks for watching.